Today I want to talk about positivity and Diophantine approximation. So these are kind of two very different topics. One is on the number theoretic side, one is on the geometric side. And all right, so what I first want to do is I want to talk a bit about Diophantine approximation, which is kind of a older topic. So I'm doing this basically in the historic way because I'm starting with the oldest theorem in this talk first. And this is the theorem by Liouville. And it's from 1844. And it says, so say we have an algebraic number alpha, we have some epsilon greater than zero, and we say d is the degree of alpha over Q, then the following holds. Then there exists some constant, and a very important point is that this constant is effective. Yeah, so by which I mean you can really write it down if you want. So it's reasonably explicit. I won't write it down. There are many ways to do that, but it's very explicit. It only involves, say, the height of alpha and some other quantities, such that for all rational numbers p over q, and I will say q must be greater than zero, such that following holds. Yeah, so this number is supposed to have the property that it approximates alpha very well in a sense, namely it's closer to alpha than q to the minus d plus epsilon. Okay, and in these cases we have q is less or equal this constant. All right, so it not only means that there are only finitely many solutions, but there's a explicit way to, if you want, to calculate them. So we can bound the possible q's that can show up there. All right, so that's the classical Liouville result. And after Liouville, there were many advances in this area, and they were done by mostly three people, but also some other people, but I will just name the most famous advances. So this is the theorem of Thue, Siegel, and Roth. And it says the same as above, basically, with two changes. So same as above, with first change is the exponent that we have changes. So we replace d plus epsilon by, so three possible changes, d half plus 1 plus epsilon, and that's the case of Thue. 2 times square root of d plus epsilon, that's Siegel. And it's also worth to note that Siegel used this better this theorem here. Let me give a so this better approximation theorem. Siegel used this for many applications. For example, solutions of the S-unit equation are done by this, and Siegel's famous theorem on integral points also go back to this. This approximation theorem that he proved in 1921. And today, the best result is known, and that is from Roth, from the year 1955. And it's worth noting that he also got the Fields Medal for this result. All right, so that's about the exponent, but there's another very important change, namely the constant showing up is no longer effective. So it's completely unclear if you, if it's even possible to find an effective strengthening as strong as these three. So it's not even known if Tuer's theorem from 1909, it's not known if this can be made effective. So okay, because I'm only saying something about, I didn't say, that's not what I wanted, sorry, not effective. That's the main point. All right, so these are not effective, and yeah, to this day, these three results are still not effective. So let me say something about one of the best, probably the best, effective results. I was searching a bit for this. I think this should be the best result to this date, but if you know otherwise, please tell me. So the result is basically as in Liouville's theorem, with a little bit of a better exponent. So as in Liouville's theorem, and instead of d plus epsilon, this exponent in Liouville's theorem, we have something close to it replaced by d plus epsilon minus tau alpha, where tau alpha is defined as 10 to the 26 d, d to the 14 d, r to the minus 1, and r is the regulator of q alpha. And okay, so this is the strongest result, I think, that is known. And it's a bit typical for these effective results that you get very large numbers. So this is a very small number. So the difference between the Liouville exponent, which is d plus epsilon, and this exponent is this tau alpha. And this is, 10 to the 26 d, d to the 14 d times some regulator. Inverted. So it's a very, very small difference to the Liouville exponent, but it's also for effectively computing solutions to some Diophantine problems, you could really use that result. So it's a result that's at least theoretically very important for effective solutions of Diophantine problems. All right, so after talking about this, I want to give the theorem I want to basically talk about today. So that's 2020. So this theorem will be about two algebraic numbers instead of one, and they are supposed to satisfy that this pair and all conjugates lie on an irreducible algebraic curve. Of degree m. Okay, and now I'm going to set this up a little bit. So take a delta in Q. Delta is supposed to be bigger than the maximum of d of m and m. And, I should have done this before, but d is q alpha 1, the degree of q alpha 1 alpha 2 over q. Okay, so we have the setup, and in this situation, the following approximation theorem holds. Then there exists effective constant. Such that if you have a very good approximation, so for rational numbers, P1 over Q, P2 over Q, yeah, so now that we have two algebraic numbers, we're approximating them by two rational numbers, but they have the same denominator in this. All right, so let's say Q is greater than zero with the property that the approximation to alpha 1 and alpha 2 is better than Q to the minus delta. Yeah, so this D plus epsilon has now become this delta basically. For I 1, 2. And in this case, we have that we can bound Q effectively with this constant C alpha 1, alpha 2. Yeah, so this is a simultaneous approximation theorem that says, okay, I have an approximation simultaneously to alpha 1, alpha 2, that's reasonably good. And then I can give this effective bound. I won't write down the effective constant, it's very involved. It takes a long time to define all the terms that go into it. But yeah, that's, I think the main point here is that it's effective. All right, so having talked about these Diophantine things, I now wanna go over to algebraic geometry topic, namely positivity of divisors. All right, and so for this topic, let's fix a smooth projective variety. Over C. So in this chapter, I will not be talking about Q, but about complex varieties. Say the dimension is N, and say we have a divisor on this variety, D. And the classical Riemann-Roch problem is what this function looks like, namely I look at the dimension of the global sections of MD as a function of M. All right, and in the case of dimension 1, this is a classical Riemann-Roch. In the case of dimension 2, we know that it's a polynomial function of M plus a periodic function of M for M large. Yeah, so this is a result, it's relatively recent. Kutkoski's Srinivas, 1993. Yeah, before it was not known that it's polynomial plus periodic, but I think it was known that it's polynomial plus some, so it's a quadratic polynomial plus something that's bounded, but it was not clear that it's periodic. So I think that's the recent part of this dimension 2 business. And in dimension 3, in general, it's not known. So nothing like this dimension 2 polynomial plus periodic statement is known in dimension greater equal 3. So maybe let me say dimension greater equal 3 to make it more clear. Right, so instead of studying the whole function, which is not always necessary, you can study asymptotics. And this leads us to the following quantity, namely the volume of the divisor. And this is defined as the limit superior H0MD divided by M to the N divided by N factorial. Yeah, so we forget the whole function, we just look at this asymptotic behavior of the function. In dimension one, to go back to the picture above, in dimension one, well, what we get is simply by Riemann-Roch, we get the volume as the degree, basically, but only if the degree is positive, so the volume is the maximum of zero and degree of D. In dimension two, the volume is a piecewise polynomial and this is you can see using Zariski decomposition. Yeah, so of course we could also use the result above, we could use the dimension two result here. But this is much stronger than what we actually need. So we actually need results of Zariski on these Zariski decompositions. And oh, but also it's worthwhile to note, okay, that it's a piecewise polynomial. This also needs some input on the properties of Zariski decompositions on surfaces. So this is a more recent result, this piecewise part. So this goes back to Bauer, Koronians, Schemberg. Yeah, they gave a decomposition of the big cone into chambers where we have these quadratic polynomials. I forgot what year, I think it's 2005 maybe, okay, don't let me put the year. All right, so this volume function has interesting properties, namely, just to name a few, it depends only on the numerical equivalence class, so that's a very good property. And also, it in fact extends to a continuous function on the Nernst-Avery space. Yeah, so extends to the real Nernst-Avery space, by which I mean tensorized. Divisors with R, so look at R divisors, and then I mod out numerical equivalence. Yeah, so this is a finite dimensional real vector space, and I have in the end I have a volume as a continuous function on this vector space, which already shows that this is a interesting and important property of a divisor. And also there's the asymptotic Riemann-Roch theorem, which I can now state very neatly using the volume function. And this looks like if I have a NEF divisor, then the volume is equal to the top self-intersection of that divisor. All right, that's that much for the Algebraic geometry part. And okay, so what I will do next is I want to combine these things somehow, this at the first point not very similar topics. And how I want to do this, I don't actually want to explain in detail what is this, the proof of the theorem I noted before. But instead, I want to do the following. I want to talk about what the strategy of the proof looks like if I prove Liouville's theorem with it. Yeah, because it's very instructive. It's basically the strategy becomes very clear if you do it like this. And at the same time, we don't have to go too much into details. So, all right. So at the first, I will define some things. Say we have some rational numbers L and K, integer M. And now that we are back in the situation of Liouville's theorem, let's define D again as the degree of Q alpha over Q. Okay, so now I want to bring a certain assumption that has a geometric and an arithmetic character. Namely, assume for the moment that we could have the following. Namely, assume for all rational numbers solutions to the Liouville approximation inequality, say. And okay, let me go back. What is this inequality that I'm citing? So the inequality is, I have a solution of this inequality, so I have a rational number that is, in a sense, very close to my algebraic number alpha. Yeah, in the sense that it's closer than q to the minus d plus epsilon. Okay, assume for every solution of this inequality, there exists a polynomial with integral coefficients such that the following holds. And now I will write down some conditions. So the degree is less or equal m. The order of f at alpha is greater or equal km. The order of f at p over q is, okay, I want to give this a name, is less than lm. And this first set of equations, let's call that one. That second set, let's call that two. So as of now, these are only geometric conditions. I have polynomials and they're supposed to have some, okay, some degree, some order of vanishing. And there's also an arithmetic condition. And this arithmetic condition is that the coefficients of this polynomial are supposed to be not too large. They're supposed to be bounded by some constant that I would not care about really, that only depends on alpha to the power m. All conditions together, I will then call them three. All right, so assuming all of these things, what do we get? So we get that if I take the rth derivative of f at p over q, so it will still be a polynomial. It will still have degree less or equal m. Well, the degree will drop down, but I don't really care about that. It will have integral coefficients, and because I take the rth derivative and plug in p over q, it will not be zero. So what I know, this is greater or equal than 1 over q to the m. Yeah, because it cannot be zero, and Its denominator is q to the m, so I'm sure that it's greater or equal 1 over q to the m. This is so standard Diophantine approximation or transcendence theory argument. All right. And then, well, you need to write a little bit. I'm going to shorten this, but let's just say we expand f around alpha, and we use star. Yeah, so we know we have this property that p over q approximates alpha very nicely, and now we do a Taylor expansion, and we only look at the lowest order terms. The higher order terms we can subsume into a constant, they're not really important. And after a bit of simplifying, which I don't want to do, you get something like q to the k minus l p plus epsilon minus 1 is less or equal c2 alpha. Yeah, so this is a different constant than the c1 alpha, and it's different only because in this Taylor expansion I will neglect higher order terms, and because of this neglecting I will have to subsume the error in another constant. So this constant is basically C1 alpha times some error. All right, so what we get is, to prove our result, to prove the Liouville theorem, we need to have the set of conditions that I call 3 satisfied. Yeah, for all solutions of star, we need to find such a polynomial satisfying the geometric and arithmetic coefficients. And because of the exponent here, so the exponent, well, let me do it like this. So this exponent has to be greater than 1, otherwise we won't prove, this whole exponent has to be greater than 0, otherwise we won't prove anything. So we need this business with k minus l greater than 1 over d plus epsilon. All right. So much from this assumption. So the point is, if we have this assumption satisfied with this condition on k minus l, then we have proven the Liouville theorem. Okay, so now I want to talk about how we can view this geometrically, and how we can use the second chapter to work here. So the geometric view here is as follows. We view alpha and p over q as elements of p1c. And we say alpha 2 to alpha d are the conjugates. Of alpha. And what we do is, we study now the blow up in alpha 2, alpha d, and we also blow up the point p over q. And just for the notation, I give this map to p1c the name pi. And this guy has exceptional divisors e alpha to e alpha d, corresponding to the blowing ups, and e p over q. Okay, so for notation, let me say that e is the sum of e alpha plus e alpha d, coming from all the alpha and all of its conjugates. Let me look at the divisor d, which is just the divisor at the point infinity, in P1C. And let me define the divisor DKL as a pullback of D minus KE minus LEPQ. And what we then have is that the properties of the glow up, that the global sections of the divisor MDKL would in fact be say isomorphic as a Q vector space to the polynomials in with rational coefficients satisfying the three properties. The degree is less or equal m. The order at alpha is greater or equal km, and the order at p over q is greater or equal lm. Yeah. So these three conditions, they are very similar to what we want in the conditions two. With the difference that in the conditions two, the third condition is that the order is less than Lm. So what we get here is basically the same, except for the third condition. Here we have those that have order greater or equal Lm. Okay. So and now I'm just going to say, take a good choice of K and L. I'm not going to say the choice. It's not hard to do, but I don't think it's very interesting. So take a good choice of KL. And then the volume of DK0 will be greater than the volume of DKL. Yeah, that's not hard to do, because the volume in the case of a curve is just the degree of the divisor. So this is kind of automatic. Okay, this means by the knowledge we have about global sections of these DKLs, we know that H0 MD, MDK0 is greater than H0 MDKL for large M. And what this means is exactly that there exists an F satisfying the conditions two. Yeah? So, because global sections of MDK0, they are just, if you look at this, if L is zero, then the third condition here, it's just not there. So global sections of MDK0, they are polynomials satisfying conditions one. Okay, and global sections, and I know that the number of global sections, the dimension of global sections is larger than the dimension of global sections of MDKL. So I know that there is a global section that is in the first one, but is not in the second one. And this global section, therefore, has the property that, looking at this here, that this greater or equal is a less than. Yeah, so we know that there is, we'll say, at least one global section that satisfies two. Right, so this is a geometric kind of thing, but in fact we know even more, and this comes by Faltings' Siegel lemma. Namely, Faltings' Siegel lemma is basically something to draw a line here that says, if I have this condition on volumes, yeah, I need the condition on volumes. I don't need the condition on H0s, but if I have this condition on volumes, then exists an F satisfying all three conditions. Oops. Sorry, all four conditions, I think, yeah. Yeah, so Faltings' Siegel Dilemma is something that gives us in the end also a bound on the coefficients, as a Siegel Dilemma always does. But the special part of Faltings' Siegel Dilemma that is that it basically works with this inequality of volumes. Okay. Yeah, so that's the idea for Liouville's theorem, without saying the concrete values of K and L, which I don't think is very illuminating. So having done the classical Liouville, I just want to say some points about how to adapt this strategy, and in the end I will say what is also the main technical difficulty if you're not doing it for P1 but for P2. Yeah, so the strategy of the theorem, if I have mentioned in the introduction, is very similar. So let DKL be as above, but interchange all P1s with P2s. So basically the same definition, we blow up all these points and we get this divisor DKL as above. And what we need is that the volume of DK0 is non-zero. And we also need that it's greater than the volume of DKL for some L. Okay, so let's say for suitable choice of L, but that's not the main point here. So this will be okay if D minus KE, or let me not write it like this because I'm already writing with this DKL. So this is okay if DK0 is big enough. Yeah, because by the asymptotic Riemann-Roch, if it's big enough, we can use asymptotic Riemann-Roch, and then it's easy to see that if you subtract an exceptional, then the self-intersection is lower, and then the volume is also lower. All right, and let me also say something about local positivity here. So here we can use the Schottky constants. The Schottky constant of the points alpha 1, alpha d of the divisor d is defined to be the supremum of all t in R such that pi star d minus te is an f on this blow up that we are looking at on x. Okay, and so this means if we have epsilon 0 less than epsilon alpha 2 alpha d, less than the Schottky constant, then, as I said, using Riemann-Roch, we can just look at the self-intersections and we see that this is greater than the volume of d epsilon 0 L. And so this works out in this case. And it's maybe an interesting thing to note. Here is we can choose an effective L via the effective version of Matsuzaka's big theorem of Zio. Yeah, so the problem is, the problem is if I'm a big enough, then I'm inside the interior of the Neff cone, basically. And oh no, that's not necessarily true. But say I'm ample, so I'm inside the ample cone, and so it's open, and it's clear that I can go a little bit and be still inside the ample cone. But in effective questions, we always have to determine how much is this little bit. And this can basically be done by Zeus theorem. Right. That about this topic. All right, so after having finished this, coming to a sort of conclusion on this, I just want to point out what's the main difference to other approaches, and also what's the main difficulty. So say we have a f in q t1, t2. Then the main difficulty in proving a theorem as above is lying in the geometric conditions, namely it's in conditions 2, and it's the bounding of the order of f at p1 over q, p2 over q. Yeah, so let me go back to these conditions. I wrote down the conditions only for one variable, but it's the same for two variables. And so the hard condition is that one. All other conditions are relatively doable. So the other conditions just say, okay, I want to find a polynomial with certain orders of vanishing that we can do by a sort of dimension count or volume argument. But the hard part is, how can I bound the order of vanishing at some other point? So in the case of one variable, this is relatively easy because in one variable, you always know, okay, I have a polynomial in one variable, and the order of vanishing can never be higher than the degree of the polynomial. But in two variables, this is of course more complicated because the polynomial vanishes along a curve. So you could have infinitely many points, or you have infinitely many points where the polynomial vanishes. So this condition becomes sort of complicated. And this is also in all these arguments. So this is in the argument of Thue implicitly, I would say. And then the arguments of Siegel and Roth, they always have this sort of problem. So they have this problem, how can we find a polynomial that has the conditions 1? Okay, that's not super hard. But how can we find the extra condition that that this order of vanishing is not too high at the rational point that approximates? This is the main problem of all these approaches. Right, and sometimes this is called a zero estimate, yeah, because you want to estimate the multiplicities, or multiplicity estimate is also something that they call it. And there are some classical approaches. So to this specific question, so I'm not super familiar how Thue and Siegel did it. I think they use something like this implicitly somehow, but very explicit it's done in the work of Dyson. So and this is called Dyson's Lemma. And in the work of Roth, and that's called Roth's Lemma. So This was done by Dyson 1947, and this was done by Roth in his 1955 paper. All right, by the way, this is the physicist Freeman Dyson, so he has a mathematician's career. I think he did two or three papers in this direction, and then he went over to physics, as far as I know. And all right, so in this approach is purely geometric. So this approach works like, okay, we know that we have a polynomial, and the polynomial has some orders of vanishings at some given points that we have constructed. And Dyson's lemma then says, okay, in this case, it cannot have a too high order of vanishing at any other point, basically. And Roth's lemma is a bit different. Roth's lemma is arithmetic in the sense, or maybe geometric and arithmetic at the same time. Roth's lemma works like this. Roth's lemma also starts with, okay, we have constructed a polynomial that has a certain order of vanishing at my given points. And now it says, then it cannot have a high order of vanishing at my approximating point, but it takes into account the denominator of the approximating point. Yeah, so it really only works with rational numbers, say. And I would say this is sort of a disadvantage of Roth's lemma. So Roth's lemma is not as strong. And it's also the case that Dyson's lemma is, because it's so, how to say it, because it's sharp, Dyson's lemma leads to a much better estimate. So in every effective thing where you kind of want to know the number of solutions or you want to do some effective Diophantine approximation, you would prefer Dyson's lemma, because Roth's lemma has very large terms. But Dyson's lemma was not enough to prove the full Roth theorem, and that's, well, why it's called Roth's theorem and not Dyson's theorem, because it worked only over, basically over P1 cross P1, but in the end, for Roth's theorem, you need an argument for P1 to the n, basically. And this argument was done by Inno and Viehweg. In 1984. So they prove a generalization of Dyson's lemma. And this generalization is in the end strong enough for Roth's theorem. Okay. All right. So I think it's interesting to see. So people were thinking about this, I think, and especially Bombieri has kind of promoted this Dyson approach, and I think also that we know Dyson's lemma and that we know that this paper of Dyson is very well known for its geometric approach, I think is due to Bombieri. And as far as I know the story, he motivated Inno and Viehweg to work on this, and then they proved this version that is strong enough for Roth's theorem. So this is kind of a strong theorem, and it's interesting to see that it took a long time, like 40 years, to finish this Dyson sort of approach. Okay, and now to contrast to the approach here. So the approach here is based on Faltings's proof. Of the model Lang conjecture. which is from 1991. And so the difference here is what Dyson's, let's not really talk about Roth's lemma, which is more arithmetic. So this approach is also geometric. And the difference is what Dyson's lemma does is it shows, all right, I have certain conditions on my polynomial. It's supposed to vanish at some points. And basically, then we know that it will not vanish at any other point, basically. And every other polynomial will satisfy that. And the approach here is different because it shows in the end less. And it basically only shows that there is a polynomial that has all these vanishings and that does not vanish with too high order at a other point. But there still may be other polynomials that do not satisfy this. So I think also the reason why it was used by Faltings and is basically that a thing similar to the Dyson lemma is not known in higher dimensions. So the Dyson lemma works only for copies of products of copies of P1. And what Faltings needed was basically products of PNs. And in this case, it's not known even if that sort of Dyson lemma will work. So it gives you a tool that shows in the end less, but is enough for all these applications. And that's also the reason why I think this way of doing Diophantine approximation is kind of interesting, because in some situations in Diophantine approximation and transcendence theory, maybe you do not need a Dyson lemma, or basically you never need the full Dyson lemma, and then you get maybe situations where you can work with a tool like this that only shows less, but that gives you exactly what you want. All right, that's all I want to talk to you about today. So thank you for your attention, and thanks again for having me.